I wanted to put the challenge before you more broadly than hand hygiene, which is how do we envision getting much better in safety and quality instead of just a little bit better every year? If we did everything that we know works in healthcare and we did it right the first time, and we stopped doing things that we know don't work, we know we'd get a lot better in safety and quality, patients would have much better outcomes, and the impact of healthcare on health outcomes would be much greater. How do we do that? Well, the first step is really thinking about what that would actually look like. And we did this actually at the Joint Commission with our board a couple of years ago to create a vision of what healthcare would be like if we were all so wildly successful, we wouldn't need any accreditation surveys and we wouldn't need quality departments because everyone in healthcare would be doing the right thing right all the time. And this is the words that we came up with, which I think are pretty pithy and pretty descriptive. It says, all people always experience the safest, highest quality, best value healthcare across all settings. And I'm not going to dissect that for you or talk more about it in detail, but suffice to say, this is now, from the Joint Commission standpoint, the vision toward which every part of our organization is working, whether it's the Joint Commission in accreditation and certification, performance measurement, Joint Commission resources in its programs, or the new Center for Transforming Healthcare. We are all aligned around helping the customers, the organizations that we work with, get to that vision. Now, you might say, well, that sounds really nice, and I'd like to actually visit a place where that's actually being delivered so I can see what it's like, bring it back to my organization, and study it and make my organization better. Well, the answer is, just as hand hygiene is a global challenge, the answer is there isn't any place that you can go to look at a healthcare organization that works at this level of high performance. There isn't one anywhere in the world. But there are organizations called high reliability organizations, and there's a science called high reliability science that studies how organizations that manage risk that's every bit as hazardous as we deal with in healthcare, but how they achieve much higher levels of safety. So we're talking about nuclear power, commercial air travel, lots of organizations have been studied, and just to oversimplify this a little bit, the literature in this science shows they have two things in common with each other. All of these organizations, they have really effective tools to produce nearly perfect processes that do not fail. And they have a safety culture that wraps around those very highly safe processes to keep them working at high levels of performance over very long periods of time. Carl Weick is one of the folks that's written about this, one of the scholars in this area, and he said that safety in all of these ventures is a dynamic non-event. The non-event part's easy to understand. That just means bad things don't happen. But the dynamic part, the dynamic word, starts to give you an insight into how these organizations actually function to keep themselves at high levels of safety. And I don't have time to go into this in great detail, but just a little bit of a little bit of this, I think, is helpful and directly relevant to hand hygiene. The way these organizations maintain high levels of safety is not by finding a few things that work and doing them over and over again the same way. It really is quite a different environment. In those organizations, every individual at every level of the organization is looking at every process that he or she touches or is involved in every day for the smallest clue that something is different here today. Something is different that indicates we might have a failure about to happen. That gets reported quickly. The problems get solved when they're small, before they blow up and cause harm, when they're much more difficult to solve, which is a very different kind of environment than we see in healthcare today. And I'm not going to deal more with that because I want to get to the improvement tools that we're using in the delivery system to solve some of these problems. We're calling them robust process improvement tools, and they are the tools that have come out of industry in the last decade or so, just starting to be applied in healthcare. Lean, Six Sigma, change management, those are the three components all together. Much more effective than the tools that came out of industry in the last generation. I'm not going to talk about that much. They work very powerfully to solve our most difficult clinical quality and safety problems. The Joint Commission is in the middle of a major initiative inside to adopt these tools, not just to improve our business processes, which is a key aim, and I hope that your organizations that are accredited by us are seeing the results of that improvement. And I know that that has been seen here at Loyola recently on survey. I'm not going to talk about that. It is also to change our culture, to get that kind of safety culture embedded in the way we at the Joint Commission work every day, so that we find problems when they're small, solve them before they blow up and cause harm. We accredit now 19,000 organizations throughout the healthcare delivery system. We're best known for the hospital program, as you know, 4,500 hospitals, but more home care organizations than hospitals. And the tools that I'm about to show you really are being extended to all 19,000 of our accredited organizations. The critical components of this new approach to solving problems really are embedded in this systematic approach that you go through step by step. And it's really very parallel to what Didier was talking about as he showed you the Geneva approach to hand hygiene. You've got to define the problem. He's defined the five moments. You've got to measure very accurately so you know where your performance is. And then the key to identifying solutions that are sustainable is to understand why the process is failing. What are the causes of the failure so you can target solutions and then sustain them over time? And this requires all of the tools of what we're calling RPI, Lean, Six Sigma, and Change Management. Now, as I said, we are in the middle of an aggressive program to adopt the tools inside the Joint Commission, but we also are using them outside the accreditation process and outside the normal programs that previously that we had at the Joint Commission. We created a new part of the Joint Commission, the Center for Transforming Healthcare. How many of you have heard of the center? Oh, excellent. That number keeps rising. I like that. Thank you. We created this as a new part of the Joint Commission because it houses an activity that the Joint Commission never did before. The Joint Commission never engaged in creating solutions to quality problems. We were pretty good, and we got better over the years, at identifying what the problems were, handoff communication, medication reconciliation come to mind, but not very good at helping you solve those problems. That's what the center is designed to do. And it reflects a message that we got, that I certainly got in my first year, loud and clear, from all of our customers directing us exactly in that to come up with those kinds of solutions. We are delivering these products to accredited organizations at no additional cost, in large part because we have found partners that are partnering with us to support, financially support the activities of the center, including Medline. Thank you very much, Jim, Andy, the rest of the Medline team. Companies that recognize that they want to be part of the quality solution, and this is a way, one of the ways that they can do that. So we've launched a variety of programs, and I will say that the way we picked the first couple of projects is to poll the 19 hospitals and systems that are partnering with us in this effort, partnering with us because they have mastered these tools of Lean, Six Sigma, and Change Management. We asked them, of all the problems you have in safety and quality, what are the most important to you to solve for your own organization? Because when we asked them to get engaged in working on a project, we wanted them working on problems important to them. As the WHO picked hand hygiene as its first global patient safety challenge, these 19 organizations voted the number one problem as hand hygiene compliance. So that was the first project of the Center for Transforming Healthcare. What we found in very brief summary, because we want to get to your questions and dialogue, is that there are a wide variety of reasons why hand hygiene fails. And if you look at these are just the top five, most of the organizations we worked with thought they were doing a lot better than they actually turned out to be when we measured really well, when they measured well together. There were hand rub dispensers in the wrong places in many instances. Lack of accountability means safety culture was not in place so that opportunities for one care worker to stop another one from not washing their hands were not taken for all the reasons you're very familiar with. Now, I won't go into these in great detail, but look at this observation. Every one of these specific causes requires a very different intervention to get rid of, right? So if you have the problem of hand gel dispensers in the wrong places, it doesn't matter so much what your accountability is if it's totally inconvenient. And what we found further, the next big discovery, was that the pattern of causes differed from one place to another. So in the row of, and this is on the center's website, and the rows here are the top 10 causes. Each of the columns represents one hospital and of the original eight, and the causes proven statistically to be important contributors to hand hygiene failures there, the patterns are very different. So the time-honored solution that we've been using over and over again of best practice, of taking something that works in one place and doing it exactly the same way in another place, will not solve problems like hand hygiene. So now our task at the Joint Commission was to figure out how to take this learning in this complex problem and spread it to the rest of the delivery system. The organizations that came together, the first eight hospitals, thought they were at the 80 to 85% range. When they measured, they found they were at 48%. That was just on two of the five WHO moments. Our starting place is wash in and wash out. And we'll add more to the programs as we get better at it. Now they're at 81%, sustained over 10 months. And what we have created, the punchline here, for this is one of the organizations that went house-wide, and when they got to a real 90 to 95% compliance rate with hand hygiene, they saw a dramatic drop house-wide in their healthcare-associated infection rate, same kind of data that Didier showed you. I'm not going to talk about the other projects in detail, wrong site surgery, handoff communication, surgical site infection prevention, and preventing hospitalizations in patients with heart failure are on the books now with more to come. We created for all accredited organizations to use the tools to allow you all, I hope that almost all of you, if not every single one of you, is accredited by us, you can get access to the Targeted Solutions tool at no added cost in the same channel that you currently use to talk to us about accreditation, a secure extranet channel that walks you through, without any need to know Lean or Six Sigma or any of the jargon, how to solve this complex hand hygiene problem. You don't need any special training. You've already got the quality improvement folks that know how to do projects. There's no jargon in here. And most importantly, for a lot of you, it is completely separate from accreditation. So none of the information you enter into this tool, none of the help you get from it, none of the data that you collect or the performance rates that you calculate ever get anywhere near accreditation operations. It's totally voluntary. You can choose to do it or not to do it. What you end up with is a set of solutions proven and tested in the original eight hospitals and in another couple dozen pilot hospitals to work on the causes that you have of hand hygiene failure. And this will be the platform by which we will deliver all of the solutions that come out of the center. So it literally is a step-by-step process by which you learn how to train observers to do the measurement, how to find out what your causes are, how to profile them so you know what the most important ones are for you to solve, choose the interventions that have been proven to work on those causes, bring the data back to the database, and show us how impactful it was. It's got a project planner in there and lots of tools that are very cute. It's been available to accredited organizations now for almost 6 months, about a week short of 6 months. There have been 31,000 unique visitors to the TST. It's been growing in the last few weeks at about 2,000 new visitors per week. There have been 1,500 hand hygiene improvement projects initiated. 930 accredited organizations have launched those projects. Most of them are hospitals, but not all. We have long-term care organizations, ambulatory settings, 40 to 50 new projects initiated every week. Last week, it was 100 new projects initiated. And 92,000 observations of hand hygiene compliance entered into this database. This is the rate at which The new observations are entered every week. It's now over 8,000 new observations as more projects come online. And we've actually now seen a number of projects come to the end of their baseline data collection and move into the improved phase where they've chosen interventions and are starting to deploy them. And what we found is really earth-shaking in this first group of 50 projects with tens of thousands of observations of hand hygiene compliance, despite the fact that it's been a national patient safety goal for a very long time, and there is no disagreement that hand hygiene should be done every time. The shocking finding is, just like everywhere else in the world, the baseline performance is under 50%. So we have a lot of work to do. We are completely aligned with the WHO. In fact, the WHO guidelines are built into our national patient safety goal, as you know. We will be expanding the use of the TST, as you saw, to other projects. But I would encourage those of you, how many of you have actually logged into the TST, looked at it? Okay, I'd like to see that number go up next time I'm here. Completely cost-free, no added cost, completely confidential, very helpful tools. And I look forward to seeing that plot of healthcare-associated infection that I showed you from the one hospital that has gone house-wide and gotten to 90% reproduced in every hospital across the United States. Thank you very much.